you know, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. So in Genesis, when God says, let us make man, here you see it in Revelation. You know, there's a certain marriage here. There's a certain oneness. There's a certain reward that Christ has got. Okay. Page 108. I got to touch a couple of these things. And it's the last Wednesday. It's the last series. Let me touch a couple of these things. You know, this is interesting. Would somebody read verse 15? Page 108. We have to try to fit all of the pieces together the best we can, but with the help of God, we can. You know, like, what happened to hell and the lake of fire? Didn't the lake of fire, like, consume everything? But now here we have heaven, if you will, and just outside her gates are all these things. Well, I thought they were done. Why are they just out the door? What? But you see how God speaks? Each situation, he's speaking of a specific thing. Like, he has to use different specific things to express himself, to reveal himself. And so here, you would think that, well, all these things are supposed to be destroyed. And here in verse 20, 15, you see they're just right out the door, man. It says, but right outside. Why? Because this is really what it is. Because heaven, the gates are open continually. You and I walk through them all day, every day, everybody. This is not your future. This is my life. I'm in and out of this thing all the time. I'm glad there's 12 gates. There's many ways to get back in. I mean, it's only one way if you're going to beat me up. But, you know, look at this. It's you and I. It's a different realm. One moment where the bride of Christ, you walk out that door, you are a murderer, idolater. Man, this, I don't even know if I appreciate this. God says you're a dog. I'm a dog. Now here in this passage, some of you know, as soon as I tell you, you'll be reminded. But dogs were used to define the Gentiles. The Gentiles were dogs. The Gentiles were dogs. And what this means is, really, it means unbelievers. The Gentile was the unbeliever. What's outside the gate? Unbelievers. Every time I don't believe in God, it puts me out of paradise. My unbelief. How many times do you deal with that in your life? My unbelief pushes me through the doors. Because outside the gate, believe me, these things, that's why I'm saying it's two different realms. It's not like you clean yourself up. There is a changing and a working, per se, but you just leave realms. You can step outside into your unbelief, or in a moment, you can just step inside and become a believer. How many times have you done that? How many times has faith risen up inside of your heart and soul and changed you, brought you into paradise? Right? So right outside the gate is what? I mean, it's just a picture of how we live our lives, and it's a picture of the goodness of God. It helps. I hope it helps. It helps me. It does help me. It helps me. When I'm a dog, that's beautiful, because I feel like a dog sometimes. It helps me. Like, when I'm a dog, I know, and in a moment, I'm a saint. I was a dog, but that was on the other side of the wall. Now I'm a saint. What you do? I just believe God. I chose to believe God. I said I was a dog. You said I was a dog. Jesus said I'm not a dog. What do you believe? The Word of God. Everything else is shifting and shaking and no stability. So that's that, and the sorcerers, this is, you know, I everything can be defined differently in the different times, you know that, right? But with the sorcerers, what I see here, it's just a preoccupation with the devil. I mean, there is a devil, and you know, the Bible talks about a devil, but Jesus' ministry wasn't about fighting devils, okay? It's about God. He brought people to God. And I always have to use Job as the picture. You see, Job did not have to fight the devil. The devil was there, but it wasn't. Opposition in life is not fighting the devil. Just go find God and worship him. And this sorcerer here, I think what keeps us from the realm of God is our preoccupation with the powers of Satan. There's only one power on earth. It's the power of God. What are you talking about, the powers of Satan? What are you talking about? We overcome him by the blood of the Lamb, the word of our testimony. It's I think it's a preoccupation with the devil. And we got to pull down the strongholds, and we got to get the devil out of here. And it's a preoccupation. It's giving more power to the devil. If you give power to the devil, it's going to keep you out of your heaven. Your devil will keep you out of your heaven until you realize the only power is my God's power. I share a simple illustration, and it's an old one. You've heard me say it a million times, so thank you for your patience. But the gentleman that called me up, and he was destitute, distraught, because someone put a voodoo hex on him. And he was in tears. He called me. I had to get over there quick. He was cursed. And when I met him, I said, you're not cursed. It's impossible for you to be cursed. You want me to pray? I'll pray. You want to break a curse? I'll break a curse. We don't have to. You're not cursed. But you see how the devil kept him out of heaven. It was his belief in the devil rather than his belief in God. So sometimes we just get too preoccupied with the devil, everybody. Okay. You can say a lot more, but we're not. Let's see. The sexual immoral. I think this comes back to being faithful to God. And God can't just be a part of our life or one of our gods. He must be our life. And I do pray for this for me and for you. And I believe it's God wants to give us this renewed or this ability to be the faithful one, you know, to be faithful to God. Your faithfulness to God will bring you through the pearly gates, man. Instead of sleeping around with every other desire and pursuit and interest in life, right? No, just two people. No, I see. No, I see you. You're good. You're good. The murderers. You know, this is our constant anger and our fights in life. You know, you're always fighting with somebody about something. You can't even drive down the street without fighting somebody. Idolatry. Okay. But I think what it all about boils down to is the last part, and God says, and whoever loves and practices a lie. They're all lies, everybody. It's all the lies that keep us from the presence of God. Alrighty. Okay, somebody read verse 17 for us. Praise God. Let's see, verse 17 also. Go ahead, Sister Sandra. And the Spirit and the bride say, come. And let him who hears say, come. And let him who thirsts, come. Whoever desires, let him take the water of life freely. This is absolutely beautiful, and I love this about what God has done with us, at least. Read the commentary with me. This verse brings us the sound of a new message. It's the Spirit and the bride. We're finally in perfect harmony, and we're bringing an invitation for all. Christ's invitation has always been all, but now there's a certain marriage to that. We say, this is for all. Come and drink. Come and drink freely from the water. There's no price to pay. There's nothing you can do to get it. It's yours. Just come and drink. You don't have to jump through a hoop. You don't have to do a dance, a song. You don't even have to say a prayer. Listen, come and drink from this water. And read this next paragraph with me. The water of life is to be handed out without any cost to the recipient. The words of life are to be given out freely. Freely you have received, freely give. The understanding God has given us is to be heralded and distributed. I love heralding this message, don't you? That it's free. It's without cost. It is not to be merchandised. It's our natural carnal mind that wants to merchandise this, that says you have to do something to get it. The gifts of God and God himself has no cost. You don't have to give an offering. You don't have to say a prayer. You don't have to do a dance. You don't have to do a thing. You have to sow a seed. The seed was sown, Christ. God sowed the seed. It's already inside you. Mission accomplished. Right? Anything that puts a disclaimer on the word of God is not God. And finally, we come to a place here where the bride is in line with God and says, listen, it's all free. I don't even care what you did yesterday. I don't care what you did today. I don't care what you're going to do tomorrow. It's yours. It's yours. That's the only thing that saves me. I'm not even going to talk about you. It's the only thing that saves me. It's the only thing that allows me to live this life of goodness, to walk in what he's given us to walk in. Because half the times I'm a dog. But I know it's free, don't you? I know it's free. Who's ever preaching what, I know it's mine. It's just mine. I don't have to do anything to get it. I don't have to raise my hand. I don't have to close my eyes. I don't have to bow my head. You can do all of that, but you don't have to. There's no disclaimer to it. Isn't that beautiful? Let us, this is a new sound in the earth, everybody. This is the bride. This is the Spirit and the bride saying, come. Jesus has always said, come. But now there's a marriage. And now the Spirit and the bride both say, it's all free, everybody. It's all free. Come and drink freely. You say, oh, it's not free. I'm just reading the Word of God here, okay? It says free. It says right there, it's free. There's a price to pay. I know. Price is me listening to you, that's for sure. Okay. All right, somebody read the last verses, 18 and 19. No, oh, they're not the last ones, but read them. Go ahead. You can scratch out a warning. Man wrote that. That's man's definition of this passage. You can scratch out a warning. Go ahead. For I testify. Okay. You know, that seems tough, but it's true. And the truth of the matter is, anybody who adds to this, you can add nothing to this. Your works, all your works will do is plague you. That's all your works will do. You cannot add to the work of Jesus. As said before, it's just a continuation. It's free. Your works that you add to this message will plague your life and everyone else that you add to this message. Sometimes we like to add, well, you got to stop drinking, you know. You got to stop smoking, you know. Okay, you just added to the Word of God. And you also added a plague to them and to you. You put a little condemnation on them and you put a little stress on yourself. A little holier than now. good. Praise God. Good. You can't add to this. You cannot add your work. You can't add your prayer life. You can't add how much you read. You can't even add how faithful you are. That's just a response to his faithfulness. You can't add anything to this. I'm sorry, guys. You can't even add that. I go to church on Wednesdays. No. I'll give you credit for it, but anytime you add to this wonderful message, this beautiful gift, you add a plague to your life and to anyone else you add it to. And the opposite is true. Not to take away. Listen, you must believe this. Not to believe the Word of God will remove you from his life. Remove the life of God from you. Not in reality, but just in the experience of it. You have to believe the Word of God. There's nothing more pure and more true in this world, the Word of God. Even if you don't think you have the ability to live according to it, believe it. And that's easy to do, right? Because I've done that many times. I've believed it. I'm not really living according to it, but I know it's true. And, you know, so don't take away from this. The words of God are true. You know, I think the story is Adam and Eve. You know, they took away. You know, Jesus said, if you eat the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you will surely die. They said, you will not surely die. So they took away from the Word of God, and they took away themselves from life. God says, do not eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Stop it. Believe it. Do you believe it? They did not. They took away, and they took away their presence from that tree. We need to stop eating from that tree, everybody. Stop calling good good and evil evil. Just look for God. We talked about that before. Okay. Verse 20 says, I am coming quickly, third time. And he who testifies these things, surely I am coming quickly. Amen. So come, Lord Jesus. Okay, I want to talk about this coming. It's written here. This is the third time in the chapter that Jesus is coming quickly, everybody. Okay, quickly does not refer to a time interval, but the manner of his coming, like lightning, okay? What a blessed assurance to know that he is coming quickly. Yes, he comes to us with the speed of lightning in every new revelation of him that we receive. Those who have an intimate knowledge of him have experienced this. Amen. We are in Christ, but he is also being formed in us. The revelation of Christ in the overcomers is the coming again. He is coming in our lives. And the coming of the Lord is not an individual Jesus. It's the corporate Jesus, everybody. It's the many-membered body. It's not this individual Jesus. That's not the second. It's not even the second coming. It's not the coming of the Lord. It's not the coming of the Lord. The coming of the Lord is this many-membered body. It's you and I. It's the marriage. The marriage is the coming of the Lord. All right, God will talk to you. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. All right. So this is a beautiful ending, of course, to John's revelation. And the absolute truth is that we have been saved by grace, everybody. There are no works involved with this. There are no works. It is the absolute grace of God that will work in your life and my life. It's truly a revelation of Christ within us. Amen? Christ in us. Praise God, everybody. Praise God. You've been very gracious with your time, so I'm going to ask Pastor Dad, if you'll close us, and remember, this is not, amen, the end necessarily. We do come in agreement with this word. So even as John the Revelator said amen to this, let us also, as Pastor Dad closes us, let us also give the amen to the words that God has revealed to us. And let us also say, Lord, let this be in my life. I say this for myself, and I also say it for you. I say amen. I pray let there be a faithful and true nature in you manifested that's never been before. So, Pastor Dad, if you'll close us. Why don't you all stand, everybody?
Praise God. Well, it's not the end. Did someone say amen?
Amen.
I think that final word that you use, because we always use it when we pray, don't we?
Don't we?
Amen.
Did you pray today? You know, it's also... complete, Pastor Mike. Not the first time. In fact, I had just heard it recently, and it impressed me because it told me, I think of where David went before the Lord and sat down. Because he knew it was all done by God. And he didn't have to do anything. Now, that sounds like an oxymoron. You don't have to do a thing. First of all, he did it all, and you did it all when you received him as Lord. Bang. The contract is signed, sealed with the blood. It's done. We do things because God moves our heart, because we would just like to love him. Not that I must, but that I'm going to. And so it's not of works. Oh, my goodness. By this time, how many of us know that? Anybody here know that? How many of us here work? Don't raise your hand. I have worked my tail off. I'm going to confess that. But I thank God because he was faithful, regardless of what I did. I did the main thing, so to speak. He did the main thing. But I just said, Lord, I want you. I remember the day he touched my life and drew me to that altar. Jeremiah 31:3, I believe. He drew me. Because I saw when I thought about my day when I went to that altar and that verse came to me and it came to you. He drew you. He loves us so much. And the other part you spoke on, Pastor Michael, he said, his reward is with him. Now, I'm not going to expound on it, just the expression of it. And we think about revelation. Oh, my God. No. It's that his reward is with him. What are we trembling about? Amen. Pastor Mike, you nailed it. And amen, amen, and amen. It's not done. It's so be it. So be it. And it will continue to be for as long as he exists. And I think he's going to be existing longer than we can ever possibly imagine. Father, just thank you and praise you, my God. So be it. You've spoken it, my God, and it shall be because your word, your promise, your covenant shall surely, my God, accomplish what you've established and purpose for it to do. So we thank you, my God. Yes, we're signed, we're sealed, we're delivered, and we belong to you. We give you praise in Jesus' name. All of God's people said, amen and amen. Hallelujah.